board, of which I will clearly not be a part.
Thank you. We now move to general questions. Question number one, Gord MacDonald.
Ask the Scottish Government what assistance it provides to veterans seeking accommodation.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
Of help and support available to help veterans seeking accommodation, the Scottish Government provides grant funding through its Affordable Housing Supply Programme to veterans organisations to build homes to help support ex-service personnel. Priority access is provided to veterans looking to buy a home with assistance from the Scottish Government's low-cost initiative for first-time buyers schemes. We have produced a tailored housing guide for veterans and support organisations which provide advice and support to veterans to help them understand their housing options. In addition, the Scottish Housing Options Guidance, published on the 2nd of March 2016, advises local authority housing options services should ensure appropriate plans, liaison and referral arrangements are in place to address the particular needs of people leaving the armed forces.
Gord MacDonald.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The latest information from the MOD has revealed that 30% of Scotland's service family accommodations currently lying empty, with the Army evicting veterans only 3 months after leaving the service. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that it's a disgrace that there are over 1,000 empty service homes in Scotland, including those in my constituency of Edinburgh Pentlands?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would agree with the member that it's in absolutely nobody's interest for such large numbers of homes to be sitting vacant. While the Scottish Government recognises that this accommodation is aimed at meeting the needs of serving personnel and their families, we would strongly urge the MOD to make the best possible use and maintenance of its service family accommodation. I therefore encourage the MOD, and I spoke to the Secretary of State for Defence on this very recently, and as recently as yesterday spoke to Andrew Dunlop, to look at what steps could be taken to reduce the number of such vacant properties across Scotland, including with regards to those who have recently left the armed forces.
Christine Graham.
Minister will be aware that some veterans, too many, end up in the criminal justice system, perhaps due to homelessness or post-traumatic stress disorder and other issues. Can I ask what the Scottish Government, together with the UK Government and the MOD, are doing to help veterans finding civilian life very difficult, which may end up with them coming before the courts?
Cabinet Secretary.
One example of that help is the Community Justice Services support for ex-service personnel in North Lanarkshire, their Criminal Justice Social Work Services Veterans Mentoring Project. It responds to a growing need locally, and that project provides a package of support to veterans who have difficulties readjusting to civilian life and who can become involved in offending, often significantly linked to alcohol and drug misuse. As well as those on community payback orders, this group works with veterans referred through social work and mental health services. Just one example of the assistance we provide to veterans in this area.
Question two, Stewart Stevenson.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to ensure children get the best start in life.
Minister Aileen Campbell.
Ensuring all children get the best possible start in life is a key priority for this Government. That's why we established the Early Years Change Fund in 2012 with local government and health to invest £274 million to deliver transformational change in early years services. This included establishing the Early Years Collaborative, which is encouraging agencies to work together and intervene early, building on Scotland's first ever Early Years Framework. We've also invested around £500 million to expand early learning and childcare to 475 hours for all 3- and 4-year-olds and disadvantaged 2-year-olds, and we're recruiting 500 additional health visitors by 2018 to support parents in their children's earliest years.
Stewart Stevenson.
I'm sure parents and children across Scotland will very much welcome the more than £500 million investment that the Minister refers to. We're all aware of the impact that poverty can have in early years, but what more can we be doing in the new Parliament which we're about to elect?
Minister.
Thank you. We fundamentally disagree with the changes currently being proposed by the UK Government and will continue to develop a Scottish approach to tackle and mitigate the impact of poverty. We are investing £14 million in 2016-17 through our new third sector fund to tackle inequality and help thousands of children, families and communities. We have fully funded free school meals for all P1 to 3 pupils, which delivers a saving for families of at least £380 per child per year, benefiting 130,000 children across Scotland. As the First Minister recently announced, we will also extend universal free school meals to all 2-, 3- and 4-year-olds in early learning and childcare when we expand provision to 30 hours per week. And moreover, if re-elected in May, we will replace the Sure Start maternity grant with a new and expanded maternity and early years allowance, increasing the amount for the first child, reinstating payments for subsequent children, and making payments to low-income families when their children start nursery and school. I could list more that contribute to a package of measures to give children the very best possible start in life.
Liz Smith. Thank you, Minister. The Scottish Government has argued very firmly that the named person policy is part of this programme for giving the best start in life. Could the Minister confirm whether that scheme is mandatory or not? Minister.
The named person scheme, as Liz Smith absolutely is clear and knows well, is an entitlement for all families and across the country. And it's also, they are designed to help families who have told us that what they are fed up doing is having to go and be passed from pillar to post. It's about coordinating services, putting children at the heart of service design and delivery. And I think Liz Smith should do well to re-look at her notes about when should we pass this unanimously in the Parliament through the Children and Young People Act in 2014.
Question number three, James Dornan.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress Digital Scotland has made in providing 95% superfast broadband coverage to communities by 2017.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, the Digital Scotland Superfast Broadband Programme has delivered fibre broadband to more than 530,000 homes and businesses in Scotland, meeting the initial coverage target of 85% 6 months early. The programme remains on track to meet the 95% target by the end of 2017.
James Dornan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. If the Scottish Government is re-elected in May, what action will be taken to deliver superfast broadband to 100% of Scotland's communities, including in some parts of urban areas such as my constituency of Glasgow-Cathcart?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has given a commitment that if we are returned to office in May, we will deliver 100% superfast broadband coverage during the course of the next parliamentary term. Digital connectivity is absolutely central to the ability of individuals and businesses to participate in our 21st century society. We have made very significant progress with the 85% target reached already 6 months early, and we will work during the course of the next parliamentary term to ensure that every citizen in Scotland has the access to that level of connectivity, which is appropriate for 21st century Scotland.
Alex Johnson.
How soon does the Cabinet Secretary expect to be able to deal with the continuing problem of exchange-only lines upgrade?
Cabinet Secretary.
The problem of exchange-only lines is being addressed as part of the rollout of the Superfast Broadband programme, and in countless communities around the country, the challenge of exchange-only lines has been addressed and the services have been delivered. It is it's a more complex solution, it involves more complex engineering, and it's more resource-intensive. But across countless communities, that has been delivered, and that is part of the ongoing commitment of the Government's programme to deliver.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the decision to ensure 100% superfast broadband by 2021. As the Cabinet Secretary will know, 97% of Arran will have superfast broadband by the end of this summer. Can I advise when it will be installed in Macri, which makes up the remaining 3%, as surely it makes sense for BT to cover the entire island in one go?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm not surprised to hear that superfast broadband will be at 97% in Arran by the summer, given the tenacious efforts of the Member of Parliament for Cunningham North in pursuing this issue on behalf of his constituents. I can't give him a specific timetable around the community of Macri, but I can assure him that the challenges that have to be overcome to deliver that service will be overcome as part of the rollout of the Government's programme.
Question 4, Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what information it has on the percentage of pork in our supermarkets which is reared in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Richard Lockhead.
Annual pig meat production in Scotland in 2015 totaled around 24,000 tonnes, and it's been estimated that Scottish consumers buy around 10,000 tonnes of fresh pork, most of which is believed to have come from Scottish reared pigs. Each supermarket, of course, has its own sourcing and labelling policies, with most Scottish supermarkets offering and identifying specially selected Scotch pork, which, of course, is vigorously promoted by Quality Meat Scotland. It's possible that other fresh pork products sourced from Scotland may also be available under own label, organic or outdoor-reared packaging. However, I have asked Quality Meat Scotland to investigate the extent to which domestically sourced pork is available in Scottish supermarkets.
Dennis Robertson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. What else do you think the government can do, Cabinet Secretary, to try and ensure that customers aren't misled in terms of the labelling within our supermarkets? And can we praise Aldi's and Lidl's for having 100% pork in their supermarkets, and the other supermarkets should take that as a good practice?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do indeed praise Aldi's and Lidl's for sourcing 100% fresh Scottish pork and urge other retailers to follow in their footsteps. And we're in constant discussions with the food service sector and retailers about sourcing Scottish produce, be that pork or other produce. And of course, we do absolutely support clear labelling to highlight the provenance of products on sale. And I continually remind the retailers and other major purchasers of food products to ensure that is a case and to source locally where possible.
Chick Brodie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what financial support has been given to expanding pork abattoir capacity in Scotland over the last 5 years, and what the percentage of Scottish farm pigs last year were exported to England for killing and subsequently branded British pork as opposed to the Scottish pork brand, and what was the consequent loss in QMS levy to Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, there's a number of questions there. Firstly, in the last 5 years, the Food Processing Grant Scheme has supported 7 abattoir projects totalling £3.28 million. In terms of the number of pigs leaving Scotland, the records from 2014 show that just over 500,000 pigs moved south to abattoirs and other premises in England from Scotland, whilst 29,000 pigs came in the other direction, which equates to a net levy loss in terms of the levy paid of just under £500,000. And we have been putting maximum pressure on the UK Government to change the formula it's used for allocating red meat levy so we can keep Scottish levy in Scotland to promote Scottish produce and not lose it over the border.
Question 5, Gavin Brown.
To ask the Scottish Government what the estimated value of e-commerce sales was in 2014 and 2015.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, Scottish Enterprise uses data published by the ONS to estimate the value of e-commerce sales in Scotland. The latest data published by ONS in November last year means that we can estimate the value of e-commerce sales in Scotland in 2014 at £49 billion. This is made up of £18 billion over websites and £31 billion through electronic data interchange sales. This represents an increase of £9 billion from £40 billion in 2012. This data is published every 2 years, and the next figures will be available in 2016.
Gavin Brown.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? Does the Scottish Government welcome the e-commerce excellence initiative led by the Chambers of Commerce? And is there anything specific the Scottish Government can do to engage with that initiative?
Cabinet Secretary.
We very much welcome that initiative, and we acknowledge the importance, and it refers back to the question I answered just a moment ago about digital connectivity, that with the availability of digital connectivity, it allows many companies in Scotland, and this is particularly relevant for SMEs, to be able to access new markets because of the openness of digital connectivity. So we very much welcome the initiative from the Chambers of Commerce. We very much look forward to working through the established structures of company development support with the Chambers of Commerce on ensuring that SMEs take up this opportunity. And we will certainly work closely with the Chambers of Commerce to ensure that is the case. I also recognise that to the issue of e-commerce has been an issue that Mr Brown has pursued with vigour during his time as a Member of Parliament, and I wish him well in the future.
Question number 6, Graeme Pearson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it will take to engage with survivors on contested issues relating to the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, I met with survivors on Monday following a meeting earlier this year to discuss a range of issues and in particular to consider a more structured approach for survivors to engage with ministers throughout the lifetime of the inquiry. If re-elected, that is something that this government will immediately put in place. As Mr Pearson knows, many survivors have been campaigning for a very long time for this inquiry. Their views, ambitions and needs are vital to the work of the inquiry, and it is important to continually recognise that these are varied, considered and powerful views. And that makes it all the more important that we continue to listen to them, to act on them where we can, and ensure that their needs and interests remain at the heart of the inquiry process and any other actions.
Graeme Pearce.
Officer, I am grateful for that answer. Since the meeting on Monday, survivors and their representatives have told me of their profound disappointment and their anger. They don't feel they are being listened to, and they want an inquiry which covers all survivors, regardless of where the abuse took place, and a system of redress that covers all survivors. Will the government work hard to deliver the promised survivor centred response they demand?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, let me start by acknowledging that this is probably Mr Pearson's last contribution in the Chamber. I know that he has been a great friend to survivors and many organisations, and I want to put on record my acknowledgement and appreciation of that. As Mr Pearson knows, it had been very challenging to reach a decision on the scope of the inquiry, given the wide range of views even among survivors. But the remit, you know, cannot be so wide that survivors lose hope of the inquiry ever reaching clear and specific conclusions. And of course, the definition of abuse and the definitions of and care for the purposes of the inquiry are very broad, and that was in response to the views that survivors expressed to myself and other ministers. As Mr Pearson is very much aware that, because he has attended meetings that I have participated in with survivors, there are clear issues about the time bar legislation and about it not applying to pre-64 cases. And I gave a commitment in this chamber, Presiding Officer, acknowledging those real issues, but nonetheless that we would have a dialogue with partners. And I am pleased to say that Jamie Hepburn announced the successful bid tender for the Consortium for the Survivor Support Fund, and that this government will be prioritising the needs of older survivors within that support fund to ensure that their needs are assessed and that they have access to that service and fund by June this year.
Question 7, Jenny Marra.
Ask the Scottish Government what progress it is making with a city deal for Dundee.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
The Scottish Government is very supportive of city deals. Cities and the regions are the engines of our economy. We are aware that Dundee, together with Perth and Kinross, Angus and North Fife, have signalled their intent to work together on a proposed Tay Cities deal, and we look forward to engaging with them on their proposals. And of course, the Scottish Government has recently committed to investing up to £63.8 million in Dundee through the Growth Accelerator, which aims to deliver a range of central waterfront investments, including the station concourse, civic places, development of the V&A, world-class digital infrastructure and Grade A office space to support economic growth and increase tourism in the area.
Jenny Marra.
Presiding Officer, Inverness got its city deal yesterday, Glasgow and Aberdeen too, and Edinburgh is on its way. Dundee is being left behind. It is a whole year since Dundee City Council even discussed a city deal. Now, the UK government say they're waiting for an approach, and Nicola Sturgeon confirmed to me in a letter that her government has not even started talks about Dundee's city deal. Dundee is becoming Scotland's sold-out city. When, Presiding Officer, and I want a commitment, if I can, when, and I want a commitment, are the SNP going to get a city deal moving for Dundee?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I can confirm, contrary to what Jerry Marra has said, that Dundee City Council has written to myself and to the UK Government on this issue. I can also confirm that yesterday's announcement of an Inverness City deal, the contribution made by the UK Government, £53 million, was substantially less than what we've just awarded to Dundee through the Growth Accelerator model. It's also true to say that Dundee have played a very astute game, if I say so myself, by getting the Growth Accelerator model in first before many other cities, and also uniquely proposing a Tay Cities deal, which will, for the first time in the UK, involve two cities working together to a city deal. I suggest Jenny Marra gets behind the City Council and makes sure she wins this money in the long term.
Question 8, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government what its priorities are for public sector reform.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is committed to maintaining its approach to public service reform, guided by the Christie priorities of prevention, integration and empowerment. We will continue to invest in vital public services such as health and education, supported by ambitious reforms to ensure these services remain sustainable and improve outcomes for the citizens of Scotland.
Neil Bibby.
Given the Government's police reforms have resulted in a Chief Constable and a Deputy Chief Constable resigning, given that its college reforms have resulted in 150,000 fewer places and lecturers out on strike,
given the shambolic implementation of Curriculum for Excellence and a series of IT failures, can I ask the Minister how people can have confidence that the integration of health and social care will be different from these other botched reforms? Given you've set the bar so low, what exactly will your version of success look like in this case?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it's well seen that Mr Bibby is closing this parliamentary term on the same cheerful note that he started it on 5 years ago. Crime is at a 41-year low. College places have been preserved at over 116,000, as we promised. Curriculum for Excellence is delivering increased attainment for the young people of Scotland. Mr Bibby should get behind the citizens of Scotland and stop whinging from the side.
We now move to First Minister's question.